NV Gadgil was affectionately known as Kakasaheb Gadgil. He was one of the stalwarts in the freedom movement. In fact, those people who joined the freedom movement at that time never thought that they will ever become instrumentalists and so on. They came into the movement as a matter of sacrifice for the freedom of the country. And Kakasaheb had a very remarkable career. Even at the age of about 34, he had become the president of the Pune District Congress Committee. And at the age of 40, he was the Maharashtra Pradesh Congress Committee president. In 1934, he became a member of the Central Assembly. And he distinguished himself along with Balabhai Desai, Govind Vallappan, and Satyamurthy. In fact, they formed the chief brigade to attack the government on all fronts.
Gadgil's father worked as a porter and then as a clerk in the railways at Malhargarh. Soon after his mother's death, he was sent to Siddhatek and then to Pune. As a young boy, Gadgil revered Tilak. The atmosphere in Pune was charged with fierce nationalism. He participated in burning of foreign clothes. Kakasaheb participated in students' activities in Pune's Ferguson College and in Bombay's Law College. Lokmanya Tilak, who gave the slogan of Swaraj is my birthright. Annie Besant, who championed the cause of Home Rule. And Mahatma Gandhi, the great apostle of non-violence, greatly influenced Kakasaheb in his youth. Jallianwala Bagh massacre in Amritsar sent a wave of deep indignation throughout the nation. In 1920, Kakasaheb married 14-year-old Anandibai Tsafekar, but immediately afterwards, he was drawn into the vortex of the Indian freedom movement. He abandoned his law practice and plunged into the agitation called by Mahatma Gandhi against the repressive Rowlatt Act. Kakasaheb adopted Khadi and also made his wife to take to Khadi. His whole household was involved in the freedom movement. This middle-class dwelling in the Shanwarpet area of Pune has the unique distinction of having housed almost every significant freedom fighter, except Mahatma Gandhi. The ever-enthusiastic hostess, Anandibai, had equal affection for the humblest of freedom workers. Kakasaheb combed through the countryside, exhorting people to participate in Mahatma Gandhi's non-cooperation movement. His organizing skills came to fore when he mobilized the youths of Pune to stage protest demonstrations before the Simon Commission. In 1929, Kakasaheb incurred the wrath of the Pune Brahmins when he led a satyagraha to open the famous Parvati temple in the city for the Harijans. The satyagraha, besides causing convulsions in Pune's orthodox atmosphere, established Gadgil as the champion of the downtrodden. It also sealed the ideological friendship between him and Keshav Rao Jedhe, heralding a healthy spirit in Maharashtra's freedom movement.
I came to know my father rather late, because during the formative or what are called impressionable age, say the age of 10 to 16, he was in jail. From 1940 to 1945, when I was at that age, he was in jail during the freedom struggle, except for a few months. But those few months, I still remember vividly. He was in jail, and we had no other source of income. Whatever he had earned was from his legal practice, which was stopped naturally when he was in jail. And he had very little savings. But he had a relation who used to help us during the time he was in jail. We had a difficult time. We were almost poor. Every month I had to go to that relation and bring some money home. It was rather a humiliating experience. But during those few months that he was with us, he inculcated in us a sense of pride. Pride of the fact that we belong to the family of a freedom fighter who was fighting for the cause of the nation.
Mahatma Gandhi's Dandi March for the historic Salt Satyagraha began in March 1930. Gadgil made a hurricane tour to enlist people's support. He was arrested and sentenced to a six-month term, the first of the many jail terms he served under the British.
A visit to him in the jail was a matter of joy. Once he was in the Thana jail, I was very young, about 4 or 5 years old. I was taken there. I didn't understand what was happening. But the jailer came along and I identified him as a kind of enemy. And I shouted at him the slogan at that time, Chai Garam, Pakoda Garam, Angrez Sarkar Besharam. My father took immense pride in me. The jailer also enjoyed. That was the kind of atmosphere in which we spent our childhood.
चेदे आणि गाडगिळ ही महाराष्ट्राची एक जोर गोळी म्हणतात ते चाले काकासाहेब जेथे सत्तेश्वर चळवळीने वाढलेले आहे ते काकासाहेब सगळ्या माणसाला
The combination of जेथे and गाडगिळ was largely responsible for taking the Congress freedom movement to the heart of Maharashtra's rural masses. It was through this momentous alliance between these two leaders that Mahatma Gandhi's message of Swaraj through non-violence percolated to the village level.
तर आता जे लोकशाही चळवळ झाली आणि महात्मा गांधी ज्या गोष्टीमध्ये यशस्वी झाले ती गोष्ट यशस्वी झाली नसती आमची संबंध देशच त्यावेळी उठला होता शहरातला मनुष्य उठला होता खेड्यातला मनुष्य उठला होता बायका मुलं उठली होती प्रत्येकजण त्यामध्ये त्याग करायला तयार झाला होता ही जी जाणीव लोकांपर्यंत पोहोचली याचं कारण काँग्रेस सत्ता गेली हे कारण आहे आणि त्यामुळं महात्मा गांधीचा आपलं काम करण्यामध्ये सोपं झालं
काकासाहेब वॉज इन्स्ट्रुमेंटल इन बिल्डिंग द काँग्रेस भवन इन पुणे He was elected to Central Assembly. The movement took its toll. Whenever time permitted, Kakasaheb practiced law, but to earn barely enough to support the family. During his jail terms, Anandibai sold her jewelry, utensils and household furniture to maintain the family. The freedom movement marched on. Driven by the British adamants, Gandhiji gave the historic Quit India call in Bombay on August 8, 1942. The whole country rose in flames. India won freedom on August 15, 1947. The last Viceroy of the British Empire, Lord Mountbatten, transferred power to Indian hands. Kakasaheb was chosen by Nehru as a member of his first cabinet of independent India. He was given the charge of public works, mine and power. As a minister in the Union Cabinet, in those critical days after partition, Kakasaheb displayed his insight in the working of the government and his acumen as a dynamic administrator, serving the common people. He skillfully handled the flood of refugees pouring into India from Pakistan. he devised a master plan for Delhi and built several colonies for the refugees and government employees. He pushed ahead with giant river valley schemes of Bhakra Nangal, Damodar, Hirakud and Koena. Within 3 months of taking over as minister, Kakasaheb prepared a program under which each province would have at least one major hydroelectric project. Kakasaheb vigorously supported Nehru's policy of promoting core industries in public sector. He laid the foundation of the fertilizer project at Sindri and the first antibiotics plant at Pimpri. Kakasaheb also streamlined the working of public mines. He worked as a team with the engineers and officers to build the strategic road linking Jammu with Pathankot in a record period of 7 months.
This sense of humor was reflected wherever he worked. For example, once in Parliament, or rather the old Central Assembly during the British regime, a discussion on salt tax was going on, and the British Finance Minister was speaking. Somebody asked him what salt the Honourable Finance Minister takes. Quickly, my father got up and said, "The Honourable Finance Minister takes summer salt."
Whether at his home in Pune or in the ministerial mansion in the capital, Kakasaheb never lost sight of the common man. His bungalow in Delhi was a meeting point for artists, writers and poets from all over India. In Delhi's opulence, Kakasaheb maintained his frugal middle-class lifestyle.
We younger people at that time were very much attracted to Kakasaheb because he put forth many of the ideas which we wanted to do. He was a champion of nationalization. He wanted the textile industry to be nationalized, the sugar industry to be nationalized. And he used to ask some of us to follow him in the either in the debate in the House or even in the proceedings in the All India Congress Committee. His was a great life.
He was a democrat by instinct and a socialist by conviction. This combination created sometimes very acute problems for him. On political issues and on economic issues, he had violent differences with both Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru and Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. He expressed them fearlessly, without caring for the consequences. But his forum was the cabinet or the party working committee meeting. He never made any issues public issues because he believed that in a parliamentary democracy, party discipline must be accepted.
Kakasaheb was re-elected to the Lok Sabha. He was not included in the cabinet, but he participated vigorously in the Lok Sabha. On retiring from ministership, Kakasaheb reverted to his old middle-class life, reading and writing a lot. He sold his car to pay for his son's education. Only when he was defeated in the Lok Sabha elections of 1957, in the anti-Congress wave of the Maharashtra movement, he accepted the governorship of Punjab. Kakasaheb is still remembered in Punjab as the governor of the masses. He was the most easily accessible governor. During his two-year tenure, Kakasaheb left an indelible impression on the people of Punjab with his equanimity, concern for the common man, his perceptive understanding of the people's mind, and the deep fraternal relationship between the Sikhs and the Hindus. Kakasaheb paid for the expenses of his Rajbhavan household from his salary. His personal guests stayed there at his own expense. He also paid for the stationery and postage from his own pocket for all personal correspondence, whether he was a minister or governor or a vice chancellor.
He was one of the persons who first learned Punjabi in 6 months and addressed the legislature in Punjabi itself. And he has written many, you know, Jabji Sahib, he translated in Maharashtra language. And as a very literate person, he picked up all the situation in Punjab. There was one most significant feature of his times. The Prabandh Committee and other people were bringing some sort of changes in the Shomni Gurdwara Committee at the time when the Pepsu was merged in Punjab. There was a dispute over it by many, created by Shomni Gurdwara Committee or otherwise.
he brought forth to them to reconcile on certain situations, and they both the sides were satisfied. So this was he done in a broader respect and to keep the Punjab intact. And agitation was also in 1960, there was an agitation. He controlled it very well through his ministry, which was led by Sardar Pratap Singh Kheram. I was also a member of that cabinet. He was a determined man and sought to it that the problems are settled in a very nice manner. When there was a torrential rains and there were floods in the border, which is called Firozpur and Amritsar, the houses were collapsed. There was all crops were damaged. He came out and called the meeting of the cabinet with the permission of the chief minister at his residence and told them what to do. And he himself monitored all help which is to be given to those people. Not only he got subscriptions from other people, but outside Punjab, he asked for the relief measures to stay. And all he visited was places and saw himself that the relief is given to the affected people of that area.
गर्गिल साहब ने जानवर बहुत पाले हुए थे हिरन मोर चीता उनको लड़की को चीते ने काट के वो दिल्ली पहुंचा दिया उनका कुछ अरसे के बाद एक हिरन का नाम मैना रखा हुआ था वो मैना मर चुकी उनकी उसकी मैना की समाधि उन्होंने यहाँ पर बनाई हुई है बेरी के नीचे
गर्गिल साहब जब सैल को जाते थे तो दोनों साइड में बच्चे खड़े रहते थे फिर वो बिस्कुट और टॉफी उनको बांटते थे बच्चों पर बहुत खुश रहते थे मतलब बच्चों के बीच में बहुत अपना दिलचस्पी लेते थे
काका साहेब voluntarily retired from the governorship to go back to the people back on the streets of Pune as a common person काका साहेब had no love for money had acquired no wealth he had built no mansion People's love is my wealth, he would proudly say. Even as the Vice Chancellor of Pune University, he stayed in the same narrow lane in Pune where he had begun his career as a budding freedom fighter. People of Pune were stuck aghast when they often saw this little great man in his twilight years patiently standing in a queue for a city bus. He was a prolific writer and was honored for his enormous contribution to Marathi literature. He was made president of the prestigious Marathi Sahitya Sammelan at Satara in 1962. Kakasaheb Gadgil passed away peacefully in sleep in the early hours of January 12, 1966. Here was a man who fought valiantly for the freedom of the country and who set the very highest standards of public life. He was among those few self-effacing torchbearers of India to whom every thinking Indian should remain indebted.
As a scholar and a matured politician, he knew what is constitution and what are the powers of the governor in the given in that constitution. But he always used conventions much more than its use of the constitution very rigidly. The constitution was primarily a holy book like Bible to him.
Gadgil Saab occupied many positions. He was a vice chancellor, he was a governor. But whatever position he occupied, he brought distinction to the office. To many people, the office brings distinction to them. But in the case of Kaka Saab, he brought distinction to the office. And he discharged all the responsibilities with great dignity.
Throughout his public life, therefore, he expressed his views fearlessly, but finally accepted the ultimate decision of the party. And what is more significant, never in his life he even entertained the thought of leaving the party, because he had a great, almost emotional faith in the Congress party, which more than a party he regarded as a movement. That is why in one of his classic speeches in Lok Sabha, he ended with a prayer, "Let my life be not mean, let my death be noble."
Thank you.